All right, welcome back to our webinar. And right now I'd like to introduce a special guest, Russell Brown. How are you, Russell?
I'm doing well. Thanks for having me. Hi, Chris.
Happy holidays.
I love your holiday themed background. It looks great.
Oh, thanks. I wanted to mention that. So this is a picture that's taken by Christopher Lowney. It's the Bembridge House in Long Beach that was built in 1906. And I thought it went with our theme of gingerbread.
Super pretty. I want to be there.
And where are you calling in from?
I'm actually in New Orleans, Louisiana right now. Usually I live in Los Angeles, but right now I'm in NOLA.
Well, there's plenty of historic architecture there. When I visited the French Quarter, I could not believe how many historic buildings still exist and are intact with, you know, the streets and streets lined up with them. So is that part of what you enjoy about New Orleans?
Definitely, 100%. I mean, walking around New Orleans is just sort of a feast for the eyes and the imagination for people who like architecture. So
it's such a creative space. So tell us a little bit, Russell, about what you're up to.
So I run an organization called Friends of Residential Treasures Los Angeles. It's sort of also known as FORT LA. Uh-huh. And our organization was started to celebrate the history and influence of Los Angeles residential architecture. So that's kind of why I'm here. And we can talk more about our programs and what we're doing.
Great. And I'll share my screen. And you see that? Am I on your front page here of your website?
Yeah, that's our homepage. And if you enter your email address, all of our content is free. So that's, you know, a nice kind of benefit of joining.
That's why I really wanted you to come on today, because you have, we'll tell people why we're really here, gingerbread. So we are going to talk about gingerbread houses of California and Los Angeles, but what I really wanted everyone to see was that there's such a great resource that's available for free. So you can see these historic structures all through Los Angeles. And actually, you know, as I noticed, some of your stuff is more even the county, right? So it's countywide Los Angeles.
Yeah, we sort of take a broad perspective on LA. Like, it's sort of Southern California.
Yeah, exactly. Los Angeles. So what are some of these things? We'll go through some of these like in detail, but why don't you go ahead and talk us through some of your website?
So we run four programs. The first one I want to talk about is called the Fort Fellowship. So we give grants to scholars and artists to do projects about the history of Los Angeles residential architecture. So we've done about 9 of these. We did a project about post-war Japanese American architects. We did a virtual recreation of Irving Gill's Lost Dodge House. Right now we're doing a series of short films about homes by Myron Hunt. So the Fort Fellowship is one of our programs. And many of those projects that we do, we could talk about open house next. So open house is Fort's way of going inside. So a lot of these significant architectural homes aren't available to visit the interiors, you know, people live there. And so we work with different types of creators to make sort of interior experiences. So that might be a short documentary. It might be a playlist inspired by visiting one of the houses. We worked with Liza Richardson, who's a sort of a world-renowned DJ and music supervisor, and we sent her into a Buff and Hensman house, and she created a playlist about what it was like to be in the house. The most current one is called Blueprint Blueprint. A fiction writer, we brought him into Castle Green, and he wrote a short story based on his experiences in Castle Green. So that's what our open house program is about. The Discovery Center, for every house that is on our trail maps, which we'll talk about in a second, we create a deep dive of information about that house. So, for example, if you want to learn about the Adamson House, you can click on the Adamson link there, and it will bring you to a whole sort of treasure trove of information about the people who have owned the house, the architects, historic pictures of the house, current pictures of the house, sort of a timeline of important dates from that house. So that's what our Discovery Center is. And this is Gregory Ains.
The Ain House.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So this is a James Homer Garrett and Gregory Ain, I believe, work together in this office. I think that's what that is. Mm-hmm. So yeah, there they are. There's Gregory Ain and James Homer Garrett.
Just gives people a deep dive, right? They can go into each one of those structures and then be able to see a lot more about the history of the sites.
Definitely. And you can learn, you know, about, it's sort of a whole kind of bibliography about that house, a whole sort of bunch of information about each structure.
And well, go ahead, Russell.
I think we have about 120 of these so far on the site, of these Discovery Center entries. They all link to one of our trails. So that's...
Nice segue. Here we go, trails.
I figured that was coming back. So trails are sort of our signature program. So every month we work with a curator, and we call them trailblazers, to develop a self-guided tour of architectural houses based on different themes. So for example, the most current one, our November trail, is called Civil Rights Houses. So we worked with Ken Bernstein, who runs the Office of Historic Resources for the City of LA, and he identified 5 homes that were owned by important civil rights leaders. You know, in October, in a very sort of different category, we did a Halloween trail about witch houses. And the curator was a woman named Amber Benson, who has written a number of fiction books about witch houses and also played a witch on television on Buffy the Vampire Slayer. So she's sort of steeped in witchness. And so she curated the trail and chose 5 stops that represent the architecture of witch houses. So that's our trails program.
That brings us to gingerbread. So tell us about your gingerbread trail that you have active right now.
So the gingerbread houses is sort of less of a trail. I mean, what we do sort of seasonally, like we did one for Halloween, and this is sort of our holiday offering. We put together a list of houses that represent a certain theme. And this is sort of Fort generates these. We don't work with a curator or a trailblazer to put this together. And they're sort of ways to experience the holiday through architecture. So for this December, we did a tour of gingerbread houses, of Queen Anne Victorian houses, that I think will kind of get people into the spirit of the holiday.
I had a question for you. Who is your writer? Because the writing on this, on the trail guide was pretty funny.
I'm glad you like it. So on each of the houses, we divided the sort of what we offer when you visit the house into 2 sections. The first one is, why is it architectural? So that's sort of a more sort of scholarly explanation for why the house is on this map. And then a friend of mine here in New Orleans, actually, who asked to remain nameless, but I'll call him out in spirit, put together his description of why these houses represented tasty things, cakes or candies or, you know, kind of holiday fun.
It's pretty funny. One is described as blueberry custard with blueberry preserve paired with a Sonoma white. for the gingerbread house. So there are 10 buildings on this list, and you can get the map you can donate, or it's also just available, right? Russell, you said that there's many options, but a donation is optional, but if you'd like to, you can donate to Fort Los Angeles. It is a nonprofit organization, and you can get the map of the gingerbread houses, including these 10 fanciful residences, but we're going to give away 2 right now for everybody. So let me go forward. I wanted to mention that the Winchester House is probably the biggest remaining gingerbread home in California. And then before we got to your tour, Russell, I wanted to talk a little bit about, like, what is gingerbread anyway? When we talk about gingerbread and architecture, it's usually a Queen Anne house or an East Lake house. This would be a Queen Anne. And you can see from this diagram that there are some, like, pretty specific identities, you know, character defining features, like we would say. You have these turned ornaments, and the next diagram I have says that it's an ornament that looks like furniture legs, which is so funny because they kind of do. usually have this like proliferation of roofs. You have the tower, these fun, you know, little glass panes. It's everything you would think of as the classic Victorian is what we would call gingerbread. They can get pretty elaborate though. So like a true gingerbread could have all kinds of knobs and turrets and things all over it. Here's dentils and trim and spandrels and brackets and finials and embellishers and corbels. And, you know, you can just go on and on and on. There's widow's walks. You can have that gable top end treatment. That, you know, the Victorians in this period, most of these houses in California would be built between about 1880 and probably, you know, 1910 at the latest. On the East Coast, it'd be a little bit earlier in the period, but out West, this is generally that time. And then as if you've watched a lot of our webinars, you've seen that these houses really went through a whole period of disrepair, especially in the 1970s in Los Angeles. They were tearing down quite a few of these homes between about 1965 and 1980. Just whole neighborhoods of these houses were demolished because they were seen as outdated. So to have any of them left over is really, really a pleasure. So I wanted to look at a couple that you have on your tour, Russell.
Yes.
Tell us about the doctor's house.
Well, the doctor's house, let's see. I mean, I'm trying to like, get a closer picture. Look at
the house. I can tell you about it. I wrote it down. So it was actually restored in 1980. So what I wanted to talk to you about was like some of these houses you show on the tour are buildings that have been preserved. This one was actually, grew up in Glendale, and I remember it was a big deal when this house was saved in 1980 and moved to Brand Park. This is the one that's described as blueberry custard with blueberry preserve. And it was occupied by a number of doctors and had quite a long history. I guess I must have read your tour book pretty well, Russell.
I mean, it's sort of magical if you look at this thing. I mean, sort of the spindliness and the decorative woodwork and all the colors and sort of the curvilinearity of it. I mean, just look at sort of how magical it is and sort of, I don't know, it's quite wonderful, you know.
Well, I love magic houses, as you know. I think partly though, what made these buildings so hard to preserve was the fact that they had all this spindly magic all over them and, you know, different surfaces and fish scales, shingles, which are exactly what they sound like. And these pieces would gradually deteriorate and would be increased maintenance, especially in a residential type of structure. But this one's so tiny. It must have been easy to move. And then the picture up on the top is from the Glendale Historical Society, showing the whole team. I'm assuming after it was moved, and they are celebrating. It was moved 40 years ago.
Yeah.
Which is incredible.
If you go to the doctor's house, one of the kind of cool things about going there too is that it's right next to the Brand Library. So mm-hmm. you know, make a whole pit stop of visiting the Brand Library, which is like this amazing, if you've never been to the Brand Library, it's a sort of amazing structure.
I know, Glendale's funny. So they have a lot of great architecture, but you don't always hear about it.
Yeah. And the doctor's house is kind of like hidden off to the side, but it's there and it's great to visit.
It's open for tours. I just looked it up online, and I included, of course, what my favorite is, the, you know, when you go to these old Victorian gingerbread houses, sometimes they interpret the past. And so this is a Victorian funeral that's being interpreted by the people at the doctor's house, which I got a little bit of kick out of that. So let me go to the next one.
So fun. I hadn't seen that picture before. That's
of course I would find that. So the Hale House, let me just say, is built 1887, designed by Joseph Cather Newsom, a significant architect and is designed for George Morgan. This building was moved twice. So do you want to tell us a little bit about the Hale House, Russell?
Well, I think it was first moved to Montecito and then to Heritage Square. Is that the...
Yeah, it said it was moved a couple of blocks at first and then moved again. I just couldn't believe this thing. It looks huge.
I know. I mean, this is sort of like another... This is... I think the Hale House, like people think of as maybe kind of LA's... I don't know, my most iconic version mm-hmm. of Queen Anne Victorian architecture. I mean, just the colors and the patterns that are on the house and the ornamentation and the sort of roof turret. And I mean, you can't really see it in these pictures, but the fish scales shingles that are on the roof and mm-hmm. you know, it's quite evocative. And a lot of people, it's always funny to me, a place like Los Angeles, because Heritage Square is such a great place to visit, but a lot of people kind of never make it there. It's right off the 110 freeway. And there's a number of this style of house, Victorian architecture, that you can see just by going to Heritage Square.
Yeah. So what do you know a lot about the history of Heritage Square? Can you tell us about that a little bit?
You know, I don't really know that much about how it started. I'm not sure. Sorry.
Oh, okay. I do.
How did it go?
Okay. So because I was living in Los Angeles when a lot of this happened. I'm pretty sure this building, but I know for sure a couple other buildings were transported to Heritage Square as part of when Bunker Hill was being redeveloped. And there were so many of these Victorian houses, which were the homes of the industrialists and the city leaders in the late 19th century, all up there, Bunker Hill. Well, we know what's there now, Dorothy Chandler Pavilion and the Frank Gehry designed Disney Hall. So that used to be a residential neighborhood with these Victorians. And so in an effort to save them, they moved quite a few, I remember that one actually was burned in a fire while it was on the wheels to get moved and it couldn't get saved. It actually was, I think it was arson, but Heritage Square is really cool place.
That one was, it was the salt box, right? That burned.
Yeah, I think so. There's some pretty decent photos of these buildings being moved. And the pictures of Los Angeles are very compelling at this period of transition when they were bringing in, nobody thinks of Los Angeles as a Victorian city. I mean, let's start with that, right, Russell?
Yeah.
Nobody thinks of that.
Los Angeles is so famous for its kind of modernism, but we really do have some amazing Victorian architecture.
Well, the City Hall was Victorian, everything that we think of is like Neutra, and things like that, very modern or Art Deco was replacing a Victorian structure, basically. Yeah, so Heritage Square is really cool. If anyone is in Los Angeles, you go there and it's like a big collection of houses. And I think there's a little general store there. All have been saved. And Heritage Square is a really great organization. I know they do a lot of tours of this house. What's it like on the inside? Have you been inside?
I haven't been inside. When I was there,
me neither.
For COVID. Let's go, you and I.
I want to go. I wanted to decorate it like this, like I have in my background. I just think it's the most beautiful place. I remember when it was painted for an ad campaign once and it became very famous, and tons of movies have been filmed at this house. So you might recognize it. So I think that's the last slide I have. Yeah. So Russell, tell us how we can follow you, get in touch with you and find out more about Fort LA.
So there's two real ways. If you go to our website at fortla.org, you can just sign up. I think we saw the sign up screen earlier in the slideshow. And you can access this trail or sign up for this trail right from the homepage. And then our Instagram is fort.losangeles.
Oh, wonderful. Don't go anywhere. I'm just going to stop my share. There we go. Well, this has been so much fun to talk to you about Victorian houses. I just think that's such a fun and, oh wait, I know one more that I'm going to give away to the audience that you put on your tour. It's the house from Fantasy Island.
Yeah. I know. I was going to talk about that one too, because there's two houses on the tour that have, sort of movie, like really famous movie references. Mm-hmm. One of them on the Mod Squad. That's actually my favorite house on the tour, the Wright's Mowers house. Mm-hmm. And then the Baldwin's Belvedere is the Fantasy Island house.
Oh, right. Why is it called the Baldwin's Belvedere? I looked that up and I thought that's a strange name.
Yeah, I don't remember where the Belvedere part came from, but...
I have not been there either. So me and you definitely have to get together and do our own tour, our own Fort LA tour. But yeah, everyone remembers that house from Fantasy Island. And that is definitely what I would call also a gingerbread.
Yeah, we'll go inside the Hale House.
Yeah, let's definitely do that. So anyways, have a great holiday, Russell.
Thanks, Chris.
Okay, we'll catch up to you later.
Talk to you later. Bye. Bye, John.
Bye.